Hi, my name's Angel Melinda, and today we're going to be talking about Sweet George Brown and the version of Wynton Marsalis Quintet. Although before getting to know about him and Sweet Georgia, here is what he sounds like. I just ran out of breath listening to him. And for all of you vocal freaks out there, don't worry, I have the Ella Fitzgerald version with the lyrics and vocals, of course. If y'all can do that with the exact same swag as her, I'll give you like $10,000 right now. And of course, he's the original version of Sweet Georgia Brown by the original composer Ben Burney. Okay, so Sweet Georgia Brown is a jazz standard and pop tune composed in 1925 by Ben Burney and Matthew Pinkard with lyrics by Kenneth Casey. And on how he got the name Georgia Brown is that he actually met with Dr. George Thaddeus Brown, a longtime member of the State House of Representatives for Georgia, and told him about his daughter, Georgia Brown, and how subsequent to the girl's birth on August 11, 1911, the Georgia General Assembly had issued a declaration that she was to be named Georgia after the state, an anecdote which would be directly referenced by the song's lyrics, Georgia claimed her, Georgia named her. You should listen to the song to know how cool it is. Ben Burney came up with the concept for the song's lyrics, but he's not actually a professional at lyrics, so that's why there's Kenneth Casey. The chorus is one lively declaration after another describing, of course, Georgia, and the catchy standard with changes ripe for improvisation also resonated for other musicians, and which is why it is performed live by hundreds of bands. And when I say hundreds, hundreds. Dizzy Gillespie, Gene Krupa, Charlie Parker, Louis Armstrong, Ella Fitzgerald, Django Reinhardt, Dave Brubeck, and Coleman Hawkins, and so much more. Wynton Marsalis, though, of course, because we're talking about his version, is an internationally acclaimed musician, composer, bandleader, educator, and a leading advocate of American culture. That's a lot of work. He was born in New Orleans, Louisiana on October 18, 1961, and at the age of 17, he became the youngest musician to ever go in Berkshire Music Center. What did you do at the age of 17, Angel? Okay. At the age of 20, Wynton recorded the Haydn, Hummel, and Leopold Mozart trumpet concertos, and he received Grammy Awards for Best Classical Soloist with an Orchestra. In 1987, he co-founded and became Artistic Director for Jazz at Lincoln Center and Music Director for the Jazz at Lincoln Center Orchestra. So he actually, in another way, got the best of both worlds because he won Grammys for Classic and he's actually an Artistic Director in Jazz. And he won the Pulitzer Prize for Music in his first jazz composition, Blood on the Fields. As for the music itself, the original key is in A flat major and has a form of ABAC, although it depends on whether it's divided into 16 or 18 or 8 bar phrases, depends on the musician on whether they feel the groove or not and wants to, you know, elongate it. And tonality, of course, it's in A flat major, so it's primarily major. As for the movement, it is generally upward by steps with intermittent skips downward, creating a jumpy, jagged ascent. So it has actually very variety of intervals. And if you don't know what an ABAC form sounds like, here's White Christmas.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas.
And here's Someday My Prince Will Come by Miles Davis. Thank you. because these are very short, so you could actually search it on YouTube. And chord progressions based on the circle of fifths define the first 16 bars, and the song takes some surprising harmonic detours. That diagram right there is the circle of fifth. And so, in summary, the melodic line is actually challenging, and harmonically, this goes through almost every key imaginable. But since the changes are arranged in a circle fifth, they are not difficult to follow. Even the chromatically descending progression in the final four measures of the song is used as so commonly as a turnaround. And if you don't know what a turnaround is, it is some sort of a passage at the end of a section, and this leads to another section. Although most of the time, the next section is just the repetition of previous section, or basically the entire song. And for the verse itself, it is rarely sung, as it actually contains what is in the chorus, and like I said before, the chorus is more lively, so yeah. Here I have for you the very, very version of the 1925 sheet music of Sweet Georgia Brown that contains the original story about a black prostitute named Sweet Georgia Brown. And here I have circled for you, it says, "Brown skin gals, you'll get the blues." But in the modern version, it is, "All you gals will get the blues," to you know, prevent racism, and so that more people would be able to hear it in like not an awkward situation way. And here I have for you the chorus, "No gal mate has got the shade on Sweet Georgia Brown. Two left feet but also need has Sweet Georgia Brown." It is actually very poetic if you see it in a very pop and jazz way. And yeah, I think Georgia is just perfect. Other than the song itself that became famous, the movie Cabin in the Sky is actually also very famous because of Sweet Georgia Brown. If you've never seen Cabin in the Sky, it is actually about a compulsive gambler that died during a shooting, but he'll receive a second chance to reform himself by making a deal with both the Lord and Lucifer, although not remembering about the deal as he comes back to life. The Lord and Lucifer, though, are still watching, with the gambler's wife on Lord's side and Georgia on Lucifer's side. So Georgia is actually the temptress sent by Lucifer to tempt the protagonist, the gambler, on this Cabin in the Sky. And this musical fantasy itself is made in 1943 by Vincente Minnelli and Busby Berkeley. So yeah, watch the movie if you can. It is actually very fun. And that's all I have for you guys today. Thank you very much for listening, and enjoy your day.